not be troubled by these times as they seem that there's no end in sight for things that are going wrong in this world. And if the world would say to you that nothing is wrong, but God would say to you, stand fast. Be not troubled by the things of this world. Be not swayed by the influence of this world, but look into the eyes of God. Remain faithful to Jesus, for he has saved you. And remember those kind words from the Lord. He has saved you from all of your trouble and all your sorrow. And remember that if you stand fast, do not waver to the left or to the right, but look straight into the eyes of Jesus Christ. And remember that he is in control of your destiny.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank God, Holy Spirit, that you have confirmed. You have confirmed your word. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Have you had a chance to hug somebody? You want to just do that for a minute? Tell somebody you love them, okay? Turn around and greet somebody in the name of Jesus. Would you do that? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Quick announcement from the youth department. I just want to invite you tonight to join us. We're going to have a combined youth adult service. And following the message that I'll be preaching, following the altar time, the time that we have around the altars, we're going to once again have Soul Food Cafe. If you missed it last month, don't miss it this month. We had a great time of fellowship and the food was great. And I do want to dispel some rumors. We found out this week that Sam's Club had some bad meat, and we got several calls this week. Fortunately, none of the meat that we served last month or this time are packaged with that company. So, praise the Lord. Join us tonight.
Praise God. Thank God for that. Well, praise the Lord. How many's glad for Hammer? Praise the Lord. It's a wonderful meat. Now I find out that you can lose weight on it. Now I've heard about four different weight loss plans this week, and that's the only one that included eating beef every day. But I'm going to stick with the preacher's food. Chicken and fish. Well, it's good to have you all today. We thank the Lord for you being here. We have lots of empty pews, and don't let that intimidate you. It doesn't mean, I know that many of our folks are traveling. The only thing that bothers me is that sometimes I have a hard time knowing where they are or whether they're on vacation or what, and we worry that they're sick. But if you live near someone that you have seen here at church and they're not here today, I encourage you to help us by giving them a call, saying, we missed you, we hope to see you next Sunday. And this way, we get our congregation back. I just want to leave this with you. Vacation time and winter time, dead winter, when it's really bad. This year, we're not going to have any snow, and it's going to stay somewhere in the 40s. That's not what I hear, but at any rate, those are two times for the church that could be devastating. Seems like sometimes when folks leave for a vacation and things, it's hard for them to get back into the groove of attending church. And the church needs to do all she can to make sure these people get back. How many can say amen?
Amen.
That's a process that we need to work on. And that goes for the wintertime as well. So just help me out, help our staff, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that we contact folks and let them know how much we miss them. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, I'd like for you to turn with me to the book of Genesis, chapter 41. Genesis chapter 41. for our visitors, and we encourage you, if you don't have a church of your own, to come back and visit with us again. I hope that when you walk into our church, you'll enjoy the atmosphere, especially the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the Word of God. Amen. The marks of Joseph. Genesis 41, beginning with verse 38, reading from the King James Version. And Pharaoh said unto his servants, Can we find such a one as this is, a man in whom the Spirit of God is? And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, For as much as God hath showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art. Thou shalt be over my house, and according unto thy word shall all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than thou. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, See, I have set thee over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand, and put it upon Joseph's hand, and arrayed him in vestures of fine linen. Or if you check into the Bible commentary, it'll probably say cloth of cotton, and put a gold chain about his neck, and he made him to ride in the second chariot which he had. And they cried before him, Bow the knee, and he made him ruler over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without thee shall no man lift up his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt. God, may your blessing be upon your holy word. We believe every word in the Holy Bible is inspired by your Holy Spirit. We take it not only very seriously, but we seriously want to apply it to our lives. Today, Lord, I pray your Holy Spirit will be present in the continuance of this service to touch our lives. We believe he must touch our lives for us to understand and receive the word, and that it be enlightened unto our hearts. So today, Lord, may our minds be alert. May our ears be open. And Lord, may this message find its lodging. Bless me as your channel and your servant. Humbly I ask. May you cover me with your blood, and may your word go forth unhindered. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. This morning, ladies and gentlemen, I believe that success, and I've preached various messages in the past on success, and I'm not necessarily preaching on that subject today, but I believe that success never comes easy. There is always a price to pay for success. In last week's service, our healing service, we preached on, and the Holy Spirit told us in the first message of interpretation that we need to praise Him. And that was the message that I shared with you last Sunday morning. I believe that praise brings healing. And it causes people to come into a place spiritually where they can receive. In today's message, we're going to deal with the directives that brings the results. In the weeks to come, as God leads us in our messages, we will learn more about the future and the prospect of success in this church and in this community. It's not an easy thing. A lot of people think you just do something and it'll just happen. Things don't just happen. Nothing ever has and nothing ever will. As my staff sits over here on this side of the platform, the staff isn't here so that we can have you see them on Sunday morning and say, there's the pastor's staff. The staff has joined me so that we can see something done. How many can say amen?
Amen.
We can see something accomplished. Not only will it take full cooperation in all the pastoral staff in seeing this accomplished and hard work, but it will take the cooperation of God's people as well. So I trust that these messages that we're preaching will bring that truth home to our hearts. And I believe that God's word always does that. It doesn't return into his void. How we face the test. Now, what I'm going to square on today is no success or victory in our lives or in the church ever comes without first a test. I believe that God does test his people. And I believe that in the end result, that it's not just the program. Thank God for the program, because we need to know what we're doing Sunday to Sunday. There used to be a day in the church. Whether you all agree with this, I'm not sure. But I tell you, I was sold on it years ago. I thought that if anything was ever written down, including my message, that I was in the flesh and that God had nothing to do with it. But I come to find out that people got tired of me repeating myself and standing up there and after every sentence saying hallelujah, praise the Lord, to take up time so I could get those few thoughts out and say that I preached. I'll tell you folks, these pieces of paper right here do me a lot of good. They help me to know what God has laid on my heart, to be able to stand in the pulpit and give it the way he gave it to me.
Amen.
How many can say amen? It helps me stay on the subject. So we thank the Lord for program. It's important to us. We need to know what we're doing. Heard a preacher one time, I'm not going to stay on this long, although I'd love to. I was in a service one time and the preacher got up to preach. And he stood there and he stood there and his eyes got glazy and he started staring. He finally said, I've been waiting for the Lord to throw us a bale of alfalfa. Oh God, where's the alfalfa? Somebody on the front pew, I was sitting over here somewhere, said, maybe it's in your Bible.
Yeah.
Maybe you didn't get that. God doesn't want us to stand in the pulpit or anywhere else unprepared. We need to know what we're going to say and know why we're going to say it. That's all I'm going to say about that. Praise the Lord. We're going to move ahead. How many's happy? Thank you. The marks of Joseph. In ancient China, the people desired security from the barbaric hordes of the north. So they built the Great Wall of China. It was too high to climb over, too thick to break down, and too long to go around. Security achieved. The only problem was that during the first 500 years of the wall's existence, China was invaded anyway three times. Was the wall a failure? Not really. For not once did the barbaric hordes climb over the wall, break it down, or go around it. How then did they get in to this nation of China? The answer lies in human nature. They simply bribed the gatekeeper, and then they just marched right in. The fatal flaw in the Chinese defense was placing too much reliance on the wall and not enough on building the character of the gatekeeper. How many understand what I'm saying this morning? If we're not prepared as an individual, we can go through the test. We can have the sickness. We can face the disease. We can go through the loss in our family. The church can go through difficult times. But if we're not prepared as an individual, many times, all that God allows to come our way to prepare us is for naught, and it's taken in the wrong spirit. And instead of it becoming educational to us in our hearts, we start blaming God because He didn't step in and do some miracle in our behalf, when all the time stepped in and said, I'm allowing this to do something good in your life. Do you still believe that to be true? I do, very much. You see, Joseph lived in an age of turbulence. Egypt was at the zenith of her power. It reminds me of America. We are at the zenith of our power. I know we will continue to excel, if God tarries, in the area of electronics and all the things that I don't understand, and they do. But you know, folks, the reason why I believe that this is interesting to me is because with all the electronics and all the radar and all the sophistication and all the Sputniks, that's an old term for what they have now, what is it? Satellite. Well, I am old. Sputniks. Give me a chance to laugh at myself. And this sister will help me. Praise the Lord. You know, with all the sophisticated equipment, they can look into my home. They can look into yours. They have satellite equipment that nothing in your home is unrevealed to them. They can focus that thing in on a spot in your living room. Yet with all this sophistication, two planes flew over New York and into the tower. I don't know about you, but it spells something to me. When we start thinking we're great,
yes.
The Bible says, look out.
Yes.
If you think you stand, you'll fall.
Amen.
And I pray the United States of America, in comparison to one of the greatest nations in history, way back in early years, especially of Bible history, Egypt, there was none stronger than her. She was a powerful nation. She had influence. Something happened in her history that could have destroyed her. Being unable to understand the dreams that Pharaoh began to have. He was a troubled man. Everything was at its peak. And Pharaoh began to feel insecure. He was having dreams night after night. Dreams that troubled him. Being unable to understand them, he called on his wisest men, his magicians. But they could not understand them either. Then one of his officials said to him, Your Majesty, when I was in prison in disfavor with you, I met a young Hebrew. If God was on this man, he could interpret our dreams. I think personally, he can help you. Let me share this with you. I was in prayer last night, and just the Lord seemed to speak this to my heart. How we face the test and deal with it and come out of it will mark us for eternity. Not only do people not forget, but it's difficult for us to forget. And sometimes things have already happened in our lives and we cannot go back and do anything about them. And they haunt us, and they haunt us, and they haunt us. Ladies and gentlemen, when one of the officials came to him, he heard it. And Pharaoh called Joseph in and told him about his dream. Here's what he said. I want to tell you about a dream I had, Joseph, about seven fat calves and seven skinny calves, about the full ears and the thin ears. What does this mean, young Hebrew? Joseph responded instantly, without thinking a second thought, and told the king that there would be 7 years of prosperity and 7 years of famine. He told Pharaoh to put a man in charge of his kingdom for the next 7 years, and to save 20% of everything that was produced and laid aside. Store it up against those 7 years of famine. Luckily, that word luckily is just the terminology. Nothing comes by luck, you understand that. Pharaoh, listen. Again, it reminds me, not of our country, as much as it does of the church of today. Ladies and gentlemen, I believe not only do churches go through prosperity, but every single church especially that moves under the hand of God will sometime face famine. Now, I know the church doesn't want to hear that, but I believe in the heart of hearts, in my heart of hearts, that I believe it could be a famine of spirituality. It could be a famine of goods. But I know a God who is able to place men in strategic positions that will say, let's lay away. This is not talking about money necessarily, but let's get our head together. Let's have a plan, and let's believe that if God gives us a vision and a dream for this church, that He will also give us what it takes to be able to have the resources when the famine comes, to be able to continue to do what God has envisioned for this church to do. How many believe that? God never initiates anything, whether it be in our personal lives, or whether it be in the church, or whether it be in this country or the world. He never initiates anything unless He has a plan of resource. I believe that firmly. You say, Pastor, has He been good to you? He's been so good to me. I can't begin to talk to you about how good God has been to me. He's wonderful. Even in the little things. In the little things. He's good to me. My car just started squirting antifreeze out of it Saturday. And it was, you know, it was Saturday. See, must have been in the 90s. Seemed awful hot to me. And first of all, it's a Ford. I can understand that. But then it started squirting antifreeze. And it wasn't the hose. I looked under there, and it wasn't the hose. And so it must have been the water pump. And it started squirting that out. And I'm telling you, I come out of Lowe's. I had to pick up some stuff for the church. And when I come out there, there was enough water on the ground and a freeze. I didn't know if I had any left in the car. And so this boy come out and he said, he didn't say pastor. I told him I was a pastor. Then he said pastor. But he said, you need some help? I said, I sure do, son. I said, I need either some water or I need to buy a can of antifreeze or something and try to put some in here so I can get home. Well, I thought he was going to really. He said, I got water over here. I'll take care of it for now. And he went over and he put 4 cups of water in my container that feeds into the radiator. I scratched my head. I said, son, is that all the water you got? He says, well, he says, that probably will do you. I don't know how much you have in the radiator. You'll have to check that. Well, it was so hot I couldn't take the cap off. So I said, Lord, you're going to have to help us. And you know, folks, we got in the car, as hot as it was, I could smell antifreeze coming up in the car, but God got us home. He got us home, and the engine never overheated. I don't know how much water to this day is in there because I took it over to Vance's, but I know one thing for sure. My God in the little things is capable of taking care of us. He's our provider, whether it's antifreeze or whether it's the power of the Holy Ghost. He is there to minister to us and provide for us if we'll learn how to walk in His will. Well, that's the key. That's the key right there. You see, in Genesis chapter 41, my text, at verse 38, this is the New King James Version. It may show in the King James Version on the screens. And Pharaoh said unto his servants, I'd like to read it from my notes. Can we find one as this, a man in whom is the Spirit of God? Ladies and gentlemen, the king looked at Joseph and said, you're that man. I believe God was in the whole thing. He made him the second highest ruler in Egypt. Now listen closely to me, you fellas and you ladies this morning. And this is good for teenagers as well. Joseph was a great man. Now that's not enough to say. Joseph was a great man. But he wasn't a great man not only in adversity. He was a great man in trial. Not only was he a great man in the hour of temptation, but here's the most vivid. Joseph was a great man in prosperity. I believe, ladies and gentlemen, that God is calling on the church to take hold of the resources that he is falling upon the church with. And that by God's help, we will see this community somehow touched for the Lord. I want my staff to hear it. I haven't talked to them about this, but we're going to get down to the nitty-gritty, and I got some paper plans that I'm going to give them. We're going to hit every home in Mount Morris. We're going to hit the streets for the youth department. We're going to hit the streets for this auditorium. We're going to hit the streets for the sick and the dependent and those who are bound, and we're going to see this community touched by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
God has a plan.
Yes, he does.
And we need to be a part of that plan to get this thing done. I believe Jesus is coming soon. What we do, we must do quickly. Here are the marks. There's only three of them. What were the marks of Joseph? Number one, he was marked by a sense and the Holy Spirit in the second interpretation. Use this terminology. It was amazing. Destiny. Used it twice in that Holy Spirit interpretation. How many heard that? That's called a confirmation.
Yes. Yes.
He was marked by a sense of destiny. Joseph had a sense of where he was headed in life. Here's a question. Here's three of them for you and for me. Are you just going through the motions in life? You have any goals? Well, if I can just get up and drink a cup of coffee. If I can just get my hair cut. If I can just get in the car. Oh God, if I just get through this day at work. Let me get home, God, and sit in my chair. God help me, I'll get through the night. And then we start another one like that. All over again. Ladies and gentlemen, that's a lack of destiny.
That is, yeah.
The church needs destiny. Families and homes need destiny. The community needs destiny. We need a plan. Do you have any real goals in life? Anything you'd like to achieve? Think about it. It's important. Well, the only thing I'm interested in, Pastor, is raising tomatoes. The only thing I'm interested in doing is getting up at 2 or 3 in the morning and struggling to work. The rest of it, somehow, maybe will go. If that's all that's in your life, nothing will ever amount to it.
Amen.
That's firm, but it's the truth. Folks, not only do pastors and churches are you. The church is us. If the church doesn't have destiny, doesn't have a goal, then there's nothing to reach for. We'll never get to it. You see, is there any real sense of destiny itself with you and me? Joseph's dreams were not crude. They weren't arrogant. Nor were they selfish. Yes,
He saw the sheaves of his brothers. That didn't go well. How many remember the story? He saw the sheaves of his brothers bowing down to his sheaf. How do you think that would work with you? If you come out of a family of 11 kids, and all the kids were bowing down and giving homage to you, you think that would set good with the kids? In the last wedding I had, I was telling them how that I went to the penny store. About, we're talking about rings. I may have even talked about that last Sunday, so maybe I did that, didn't I? I keep forgetting, and Rose keeps reminding me. But anyway, Ted would always, my twin brother Ted and Fred. Never Teddy and Fred. Ted and Fred. He'd get candy, I'd get a ring. One of those adjustable jobs. We had to go through the woods before, never failed. Before we got out of the woods, we were in a fist fight. Why was it? Why were you fighting, Pastor? Because I wanted my ring, and I wanted his candy too. We fought over it. We fought over it. I had a sense of destiny. That's a crude example, isn't it? You see, he saw his brothers making homage or obeisance to him. He was shown in the dream of, or the vision of, the moon and 11 stars, the number of his brothers. They hated him for it. But yet his dreams were not arrogant. They were sacred or sacramental. They had to do with greatness, ladies and gentlemen. You see, dreams aren't just dreams unless you ate too much spaghetti. Dreams aren't just dreams. Dreams have a meaning. In many cases, dreams send a message. The Bible says in the last days, they would dream dreams and see visions, young and old. And I believe today, when Joseph's brothers saw him afar off that morning, they said, "Let's kill him. Let's get rid of him. We never liked him anyway. He's a papa's pet. We're not a pet, but he is. We're not going to put up with him in the family anymore." Now, I got something I got to say here. Ladies and gentlemen, if there's anything the devil will tell you or me in this church, is that when folks are some way maybe used in the gifts of the Spirit or something else, or doing something else, somebody may think in their heart, because of the devil, that person is the pastor's pet. The devil will tell you those things. I treat everybody equally in this church. But the devil will tell you he spends more time with them than he does with them. He gives them more to do than he does them. The only people that do things in the church here is people who...
That's right.
And we use them when they come. When Joseph revealed... Well, let me go back just a moment. If you will read the account in Genesis, you will see that the famine surely came in Egypt. The family, the boys came to buy food. You remember the story, they didn't recognize him. And when Joseph revealed his identity to them in love and humility, the Bible says that they wept. And then portraying his character in his sense of destiny, his sense of a goal, he said in Genesis chapter 50 and verse 20, "But as for you, listen to me, I've said this scripture so many times when I go through hardship, I'd say, God, reveal this to me. You fought evil against me, but God meant it for good." And every time some person or some situation seems to abuse us, and there'll always be somebody or something that'll be screwed in your way of success, I tell you, turn your face to God and say, "God, do you mean this for good?" And if you do, like the the end of the verse, lives will be saved for it. That's what the scriptures say. See, this man's destiny was God's divine plan for the survival of Israel. But it goes further than that. I don't know about you today, but I would like for my sense of destiny to play a part in the survival of this great church. And I'm not saying this to blow my own horn or anything, because I wouldn't want to do that. But somebody asked me, not long ago, somebody said, why do you work so hard? Why do you work so hard? Because I have a sense of destiny. I'm not here to goof off. I'm here to get God's work done. I don't know whether you believe that, but I believe that. You've got to have a destiny. You've got to have a goal in life. You've got to believe that what you're involved with is going to bring the goods. You're going to bring the answer. Number two, not only was Joseph's life marked by a sense of destiny, but secondly, Joseph was marked by unshakable integrity. Integrity is what Joseph was inside his own personal life. You know, face it, folks, we put our best face on when we come to church. I know you ladies really do, but I'm just kidding. God, why did I say that? You have an answer for that, sister? I was thinking about the stuff, the black stuff, the brown stuff. This looks brown to me. You see, Joseph worked for Potiphar. Entrusted with everything Potiphar owned, including his wife. Think about it. Potiphar's wife was so attracted to Joseph, he must have been a handsome young man. Almost said something. Potiphar's wife was attracted to Joseph. And I'm going to be very frank with you. She asked him to sleep with her. Now comes the fiery trial of temptation. Joseph stood the test. You see, ladies and gentlemen, he was a man of unshakable integrity. He turned to the woman. I'm sure it took a little time. She just didn't walk up and say, you know, let's go back to the back of the house. And he'd say, well, no, I'm sure there was a procedure and a process there. And she began to work closer to him and closer to him. How many know what the devil does? Over a period of time, when the final tally came, Joseph said, no. You see, the tempter whispered to Joseph in his mind. Said, Joseph, you're only a slave. I don't care what Pharaoh said. You're a slave. You came into Egypt tied to the back of a camel. The Ishmaelites drug you through the desert and brought you to this forgotten place as far as you're concerned. Took you from your father's house and from your family. You're nothing but a slave. You're far from home. Your God hasn't saved you from Egypt. You're still here. God's forgotten you. Why should you be true to a God like that of Israel? Well, church, how did he win this victory that day? It's told to us in Genesis 39, verses 8 and 9. Now you say, Pastor, is that the only thing this touches on is maybe an immoral act?
No.
Every time we're tempted to go back to the life we used to live, we need to ask God to keep us straight in our spirit of integrity. That's why I preach so much. Some people like it, some don't. But I'm going to continue to do it. What I have preached, the basics of Christianity, the basics of holiness in the church, I will never deviate from them. I will never. It's the course that have brought me where I am. Not that I'm great or anything, but I'm a pastor in the Assemblies of God. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost, and I'm on my way to heaven. And I'll tell you something, folks. It's integrity that gets you there. It isn't some popular name. It's integrity. It reminds me, in 1959, 40-year-old Ted Williams, that's more like my age. Ted Williams of the Boston Red Sox was suffering from a pinched nerve in his neck. It was so bad that I could hardly turn my head to look at the pitcher. For the first time in his remarkable career, he batted under 300, hitting just 254 and only 10 home runs for the whole year. Williams was the highest salaried player in sports that year. The highest salaried player in sports that year. He made $125,000. Sinking in? The president doesn't even make as much as sports characters make today. The next year, the Red Sox offered him the same cut, the same contract. But I told them I wouldn't sign it until they gave me the full pay cut allowed. 28%. My feeling was that I was always treated fairly by the Red Sox, and they were offering me a contract I didn't deserve. Williams cut his own salary by $35,000. Talk about integrity. Today, they get millions of dollars and get a scratch and sit on the pier.
Yep. Yep. Yes. Amen.
Where has integrity went? Whether it be in sports or in the church. Are you with me?
Yes.
Many people today have the character of a grapefruit. They come in sections. They're strong here and there. We need godly integrity, ladies and gentlemen. Joseph had convictions. Hallelujah. And he stuck to
them. Amen.
He stuck to them. I urge the church, I wish all of our church was here today. Not because this is such a great sermon in delivery, but I believe it's got powerful content. I wish our whole church body could be here today to hear this. Because, folks, if there's anything the church needs to pray for in these last days, if we're going to go through famine, if we're going to go through hardship, if we're going to go through trials, let's keep integrity.
Amen.
Let's do it God's way.
Yes. Yes.
Instead of man's way. Number three. Not only was Joseph marked by a sense of destiny and marked by unshakable integrity, but last, Joseph was marked by a commitment to excellence. How does one measure excellence? I just heard this yesterday, that there was something put out in the news. I didn't get to see this, but somebody else told me about it, and said that many of the companies that are out of the United States, car builders, are mentioning that the quality of cars, in many cases coming from American factories, are not as high a quality as they should be. Hey folks, I bought a brand new car. I'm sorry to say it was a Chevy, because I love Chevy. There wasn't screws in the door panels. When they put the windshield in, this is a brand new Caprice, When they put the windshield in, the tar sealer they used around was all over the dash. The first day I took it home, the brakes wouldn't work. Brand new car. What's happened to a sense of excellence? Whether it be in car dealing or car manufacturing, or whether it be in the church, what we do for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ ought to be first class.
Amen.
Amen. It ought to be first class. What we do for the gospel's sake ought to be the best it can be. We want our homes to be the best. We want our cars to be the best. We want our clothes to be the best. But for some unknown reason, the church over the years has taken second place to those things. And it has to struggle getting the message across. What we do for God also ought to be first class.
Amen.
Amen. Trying to sell something this morning, Pastor? No, I'm not. I have no ulterior motives at all. The only thing I'm trying to sell is something to myself. I need to be a better pastor. I need to be a more powerful pastor that can reach people with these marks. You see, how does one measure excellence? How does one measure success? These statements are in closing. First, Bill O'Neill wrote, "You got to know the will of God. How do I do that? Well, you got to seek the Word of God. God's will never be abstinent to His Word. It will always be in coalition with His Word. Just because we get a good feeling about something doesn't mean it's God's will. It's got to be according to His Word. The long series of trials and dreams and rewards had taught Joseph something. We know that Christ in His work depended on Joseph. I don't know if you've ever thought of that, but we preached a few weeks ago about Abraham and how he was part of the bloodline. Joseph was also part of the bloodline of Christ. And I believe that the Son of God depended on Joseph. If Joseph would have thrown all that away, it could have hindered that continuity of bloodline of Christ. Jesus knew that. I believe we know that Christ is at work in His church. The world's interpretation of success or excellence is different from that of the man of God. The world says success is owning a Mercedes-Benz or a Rolls-Royce, but God says in Matthew 6:33, you know it and I know it, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you." Reminds me when I talk about excellence, integrity. The pastor preached a sermon. This really got to me because I got to watch. If I preach on a subject, somebody may test me in the community. A pastor preached a sermon on honesty one Sunday. On Monday morning, he took the bus to get to his office. He paid the fare, and the bus driver gave him back many, many, many dollars too much in change. During the rest of the journey, the pastor was rationalizing how God had provided him with some extra coffee money and food money. But he just could not live with himself as he sat on the seat of the bus. And when he got ready to leave, he said to the bus driver, "You give me too much change." And he proceeded to give him back the many dollars. The driver smiled and said, "There was no mistake, sir. I was at your church yesterday. And I heard you preach on honesty. So I decided I'd put you to the test."
How many can say amen to that? You see, ladies and gentlemen, integrity and excellence, honesty, is all part of what it takes to make a great man out of nothing. That's what it takes to make a great church out of nothing. That's what it takes to make a great name in the community out of no name at all. It's integrity, excellence. That's the marks that Joseph had. Matthew chapter 16 and verse 25, I think, is a real important scripture. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. And again, this is my second time to close, but this is closing. Who would have dreamed that the young Hebrew lad, bound to those camels, to that camel, swaying down through the desert into Egypt, put in prison in the deepest of dungeons, in the providence of God, would become the deliverer of Israel of that day? Ladies and gentlemen, here's what it tells me, and Paul said it. Not that I have already obtained all this. This is the NIV. Or have already been made perfect. But I press on to take hold of that which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press toward the goal, to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Listen to me. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? Ladies and gentlemen, Joseph's experience tells us that this world is a testing ground where souls are made or broken. Life here is only a probation, a time to develop spiritual and moral qualities in a man and in a woman. Sir, lady, this man Joseph is a role model for your pastor. And I take it very seriously this morning. Why? Because I want to be a man of destiny. I want to have a plan. I want to be a man of integrity, a man of honor. I want to be a man of excellence, God-centered, God-sanctified, God-minded, God-envisioned, that He can show me His glory and His will until He takes me. I'm not going to ask for a raising of hands on this Sunday. It's just barely 12. Somehow I feel led. Some of us are struggling here today with some of these very things. Why is our family under so much pressure? Why does everything we do seem to be a struggle? What's going on? Maybe God has taken something bad and allowed it to come to good. But you've got to go through the process. You've got to learn what God is doing, so that when it's all done and said, He'll be able to do what He wants to do in your and my life. If you're here this morning, you would like for God to touch your circumstance, I'm going to ask you to step out of your pew, walk to this altar, say, Jesus, whatever it takes to be a man of integrity, a man of destiny, man of excellence, I'll do whatever I have to do to prove myself to God and to man. Step out of your place, if that's God speaking to you. But wait just a moment. The Holy Spirit speaks. Thank you.
thought evil against me. But God meant it for good. To bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. Ladies and gentlemen, that's what it's all about. It's not about me. It's not just about you. It's about God's people. It's about the unsaved. It's about our community. It's about our church. God, help us today. Help us today. Thank you, Jesus. Folks are still coming, so I've just got to wait a second. Holy Spirit does things in His time. Don't leave this church if you're battling. Ask God what to do. See, God, what am I supposed to do? Ministry in this church.